It's Bullseye. I'm Jesse Thorn. My first guest this week is Boz Scaggs. He's a singer-songwriter with a career that now spans 5 decades. He's recorded psych rock, folk, soul, and smash hits like this one. That was Lowdown from Scaggs' 1976 album Silk Degrees, a record that went platinum 5 times. Lately, like a lot of rockers his age, his work has steered more toward the basics. Some blues, some covers here and there, lots of stripped-down instrumentation. But behind all that has been a commitment to atmosphere and production, music with an aesthetic that's dark and unsettling in one moment, then in another tender and loving. You know, the kind of thing that makes Boz Scaggs, Boz Scaggs. He just put out a new album. It's called Out of the Blues. Let's listen to a single from it. It's called Rockin' Stick. Boz Scaggs, welcome to Bullseye. I'm so happy to have you on the show.
No, thanks, Jesse. Nice to be with you.
So this is this new record is the last of 3 albums that kind of like look back at the things that influenced you as a young man. Do you feel like you are at that point in your life where retrospection is in order?
Yeah, in a way. This is not the first record I've made that sort of explores this territory, but these 3 records are of a piece. I just like doing it. I like to sing these things. And the point of it was just to make music with people I wanted to make it with and not be responsible for writing all the songs or any other sort of thematic thing. It's the only criteria was songs that had some particular interest to the producer. The first couple of records I produced were produced by Steve Jordan, a drummer and extraordinary music guy. And I produced the 3rd one. But it was just what we would like to explore. We both have a great curiosity about early rock and roll and R&B, of course, and the blues. So we started with a list of many songs and whittled it down to 15 or 20 as we went into each of these recordings. And they were songs that just were interesting for different reasons and songs that we thought that we could give our own spin to.
You were born in the mid-40s. Do you remember the first rock songs that you heard?
Yeah, I do. I was, as you having been born at that time, I was among that first generation of radio brats who grew up on early top 40 rock and roll. And there were, of course, predecessors to rock and roll, the Louis Jordan and stuff like that in the 40s and early 50s. But yeah, the Bill Haley's Rock Around the Clock. Early Elvis and Fats Domino. That first wave was really came through for me in my generation.
What did you think of them at the time? I mean, you were like 12, 13 years old, however. You know, that's like the time.
That was it. I was, 9, 10, 11. I was in the 6th grade. I remember my first, buying my first singles and hanging out with a few kids during the lunch hour and playing, each of us bringing in our own records and listening to each other's and hearing, Maybelline when I was 11. But yeah, it was something that was just in the zeitgeist, so to speak. You know, we had always heard our parents' generation's music. They had things like Your Hit Parade.
The following program is Your Hit Parade, as originally telecast Saturday, June 2nd, 1956.
Which was on in the 50s, and every week the top 10 songs would play. But that was my parents' generation. And then, like, out of nothing, there suddenly appeared a whole new batch of material from people that were definitely not my parents' first choice.
Were there particular songs that you remember blowing your mind when you were a teenager?
Yeah, sure. Elvis's Mystery Train was a huge. Actually, all of Elvis's early hits. It was like, to a later generation, it might have been the Beatles, or later than that, it might have been, I don't know, Radiohead or something. But it was when a new Elvis song came out on Top 40. That was big.
Well, since my baby left me, well, I found a new place to dwell. Well, it's down at the end of Lonely Street, that heartbreak hotel where I'll be just a lonely baby. Well,
and then it was Chuck Berry that got me big. I heard Maybelline for the first time, and it was as if it were being broadcast from outer space.
Maybelline, why can't you be true? Oh, Maybelline, why can't you be true? You done started doing the thing you used to do.
It was so beautiful and so exotic and so rocking, and the lyrics were so mysterious. And then Ray Charles had to have been the biggest hit of all to me. And I actually got to see Ray Charles when I was about 14 in concert when he was at the peak of his, I saw him in about 57 or 58, and What I Say and a whole string of hits were on the air.
Hey, mama, don't you treat me wrong. Come and love you, daddy, all night long, all night long.
I had a long playing record of his, and I knew the songs and I knew the hits, and I got to see him in an auditorium of about 3,000 people, and it rearranged my the molecules in my brain. I'm still sizzling.
At first, you were just kind of like a singer, tambourine player. At what point did you like start to think of yourself as a musician rather than as a guy who played music?
It was really much later on. I was a little bit of a drifter as a late adolescent. And I traveled. It was Vietnam time, and I went in the Army for about 6 months, and I left school. I didn't really go to too much college, and I had a band in Austin, Texas, when I was about 19, I guess. And through a series of events, I ended up going to Europe and living there for about 3 years, and I played in little clubs and played it with some different bands and different kinds of music. And it was only when I came back to the States in 1967, and I had a girlfriend in San Francisco, and we had to get an apartment. And it's the first time it occurred to me that I really had to, like, settle down, pay some rent. And so I put together a band and started playing clubs around San Francisco, and it finally, the light bulb went on, and it occurred to me that I really am. I'm a professional now. I've been a part of some records. I've got my own record on a label, and the whole thing dawned on me when I had to put together that band, the responsibility of taking on those musicians and taking care of them and getting new tires for the band and getting dentist appointment for the piano player's girlfriend. And I got to work. I got busy. I got busy in about 1969 or 1970. And I didn't have a break for 10 years. I worked every day, everything, anything that needed attending to, I did. And I got another recording contract. And then I'm a full-on pro at that point. But it really took a while for me to sort of get away from the drifter, wanderlust part of the equation to just settling into music.
I want to play a song from your first album, which was recorded in 1965 when you were bumming around in Europe.
Oh, my God.
And you got, I mean, there's like, this is like, I looked on Discogs, which is, you know, a website where you buy used records, and you gotta pay $150 if you want a copy of this thing, because apparently there was only, 1,000 or something pressed.
Oh, my God. I can't believe you pulled that out.
This song's called Got You On My Mind. I think you recorded this album like in a, this was one of those things where you got like 2 days in a recording studio or something.
I remember maybe one, but it could have been 2 days. Yeah, that's right.
Let's take a listen to my guest Boz Scaggs, as at the time William R. Scaggs, on from his 1965 album Boz, released and recorded in Sweden?
Stockholm, yeah, in Sweden. Mm-hmm. The Carousel was the record label.
Got you on my mind, feeling kind of sad and low. Got you on my mind, feeling kind of sad and low.
Wow, I haven't heard that in all these years. It's not too bad.
No, it sounds pretty good. I mean, it sounds like you recorded it in one day, but it sounds pretty good considering.
Those compressors are pulling and yeah. All right.
I mean,
well,
when
that's
you
amazing were... that you pulled that out, and I'm really surprised to hear that. Thanks for the surprise, actually.
Sure. I want to play a little bit of a song from your first record, which was called Boz Scaggs. This record, did you record this in Muscle Shoals?
That's right, yeah.
And Muscle Shoals is a very legendary recording studio where many, many great hits were recorded, particularly there was a long string of soul hits in the mid-1960s into the late 1960s, and then many other hits straight through the 70s. I think Dwayne Allman had played there but was off doing the Allman Brothers or the Dwayne Allman Band or something, and you kind of brought him back to play with you on this record?
That's right, yeah. Dwayne had been a regular session player in Muscle Shoals for some time. He was one of the first guys that from the South that they knew that had really began to make a career of playing. Himself had ventured out into a larger world, and he had long hair, and he was as something of a renegade from the world that they lived in. But as a person and as a musician, he was very, very highly respected by not only those guys, but a lot of the clients that came in, Aretha Franklin and Wilson Pickett and Clarence Carter and people who had mainline careers in rhythm and blues knew about Dwayne Allman and had respect. And he was charismatic. He was very humble, really highly respected, and a wonderful, wonderful fellow.
Well, let's hear Dwayne Allman playing guitar on my guest Boz Scaggs' record, Boz Scaggs. The song's called "Loan Me a Dime." It's like more than 12 minutes long, so we are checking in with it. It starts as a relatively slow kind of bluesy song, and it builds about two-thirds of the way through, and we're checking in as things kind of hit their peak. Did you have like a path for your career in mind by that point in your life?
No, not at all. It was just one foot in front of the other at that point. I made the record in Muscle Shoals and hung around Macon for another 6 months. And it was because, you know, I was beginning to get the idea that I needed to make some money. I need to settle down and I wanted to stay in San Francisco for a while, and I needed a gig, so I had to put together a band. And then, as I said, the light bulb went on, and I started taking my my career as a musician a lot more seriously, and taking care of musicians and a lot of business.
Well, let's hear one of the gargantuan hits from your gargantuan hit album from 1976, Silk Degrees. And my guest is Boz Scaggs, and this is Lido Shuffle. I wrote on Twitter today that you were going to be a guest on the show, and somebody just tweeted me, please ask how he got so many hooks into Lido Shuffle.
The groove was just a shuffle, a New Orleans kind of Fats Domino thing in my head. But I was working with this young rhythm section of great, great young players who had their finger on the pulse, I should think, I guess the best way to say it. They had their finger on the pulse of contemporary music, and that was just a style that they played in, and that's the way it came out in the studio. It was the arranger David Page, I would think, that gave it a lot of its character. Those guys went on to, for those who don't know, went on to become the band Toto. They were teenage high school kids. And they just were really tuned into the L.A. session scene and popular music and the black music dial as well. So it came together for all of us with my recording.
Welcome back to Bullseye. I'm Jesse Thorn. I'm talking with the singer-songwriter Boz Scaggs. He recorded hit songs like The Lowdown, The Lido Shuffle, and more. His latest album, Out of the Blues, is out now. Let's take a listen to another song off his new record. This song is called I've Just Got to Forget You.
I've just got to forget you. That's one thing I've got to do. Oh, I know you don't love me half as much as I loved you.
Is it a different experience for you singing in your 70s than it was when you were in your 20s and 30s?
Oh, yeah. It's a much different experience. The music was in me, the sound of my voice was there, the desire to do it that way, but I don't feel like I had the instrument to do it that I have now. I'm more confident in my voice. I've gotten the, I feel like my style's more intact, and I feel like I'm accomplishing more of what I want to as a singer now. And it's very, very satisfying for me. I've worked really hard, with my voice to try to find that voice that's in my head. And I feel that, finally I can do, a lot of the stuff that I want to do with my voice. There are challenges, and but I think I've found a way to solve some of the problems that I've had, or find some technique to get myself closer to what I feel about the music through my voice.
You know, it's funny that I described at the beginning of our conversation this is a series of albums that in some ways are retrospective, but they also feel a little bit like you enjoying your craft, that you've, you know, in covering these songs that you love, part of what you're doing is, you know, appreciating the skill that you've developed over your now 50-some years as a professional musician.
Yeah, well, I'm really glad that comes through, because it certainly is high on the list of reasons that I'm doing this now. I love what I'm doing, and I'm really having fun when I don't have to write my own songs.
Well, Boz,
call me lazy, but no, it's a great feeling to be able to look at this music that I love.
Boz, I'm so grateful to you for taking the time to come beyond Bullseye, and I so enjoyed your new album, Out of the Blues.
Well, thanks. Thanks a lot. I enjoyed being with you, Jesse.
Let's go out, we might as well, on another wonderful track from my guest Boz Scaggs' most recent record, Out of the Blues. It's a cover of a Neil Young song that folks might not even have heard, that's called On the Beach.
I went to the radio interview, but I ended up all alone at the microphone. Now I'm living out here on the beach, but those seagulls are still out of reach.
Boz Scaggs. His new record is Out of the Blues. You can buy it, download it, stream it pretty much wherever. He just kicked off a huge nationwide tour with shows in dozens of cities. We'll have a link to dates on the Bullseye page at MaximumFun.org.